Okay, we're gonna jump around this chapter, so just as you look at your, your notes there, we're gonna be kind of jumping around as we go. Thyroid gland, what does it do? What's the purpose behind it? Outside of just being there. So it's a regulator of calcium. What else?
Metabolism.
Does it play a part in terms of metabolism? Yeah. So what happens when you have a hyperside of thyroid or a hypothyroid of thyroid? Are you gonna have issues in terms of what's going on with your metabolism side? So as we start talking about disease processes of hypothyroidism, keep that in mind in terms of it's gonna play a part in terms of what you see with your patients. Okay? Adrenal gland is the other one we're gonna be talking about. So let me run forward here. Adrenal medulla, adrenal cortex, what's the difference? Adrenal medulla, adrenal cortex, because we've talked about both.
Cortex is the outer layer, medulla is the inner layer.
Okay, good. What else about it? What is it? What does it secrete? You're right, Jason, but what else does it secrete? So adrenal medulla secretes what?
Norepinephrine.
And what does adrenal cortex secrete?
Cortisol.
So the corticosteroid plays a part in terms of our immune system. So again, think about this from the disease process when we start talking about hyper issues with adrenal and hypo issues with adrenal. And so it's going to play a part in terms of what's going on with your immune system along the way. Yeah? Starting with the thyroid gland, there's something that's called thyrotoxicosis disorder, prolonged exposure to a thyroid hormone. The most common one that you hear out of this, and I'll show up and let you write and then we'll talk. Do you need help getting it out?
I'll just
appreciate you, you're awesome. Graves' disease is a subcategory of thyrotoxicosis. Yeah. So when we talk about autoimmune disease, what are we talking about there, guys? The body will be in conflict with itself on a continuous basis. It's always going to be attacking itself in terms of what's going on, right? So to that, it stimulates the thyroid tissue to produce excessive hormones. T3, T4 are the two that you need to hear about with thyroid type hormones. It's the primary thyrotoxicosis disease. All those other ones, this is the one that you hear about the most. So check this out. In this pea brain of mine, there's a way of trying to keep this simple, okay? And so I think about this in terms of what we're talking about from the thyroid thing, from the adrenal gland, I think about it as being an upper, and I think about it as being a lower in terms of disease processes. This Graves' disease is one of the uppers on the thyroid side. So how is your patient going to present? How is this person? Say again. So protruding eye, what else?
Anxiety.
Weight
loss.
Say again.
Weight loss,
why?
It's a hyper-metabolism.
Right. So the idea is that this person generally cannot be. What else? So they may have a goiter. Yeah, we'll talk about that. What else? Is this the person that's going to be hyped up, or is this the person that's going to be slouched down? This is the person that's going to be hyped up. This is the person that's going to be tacky. This is the person that is going to be anxious, always moving, anxiety along the way. Okay? So one of four that we talk about here. There you go. Again, I'll let you write in with us.
upper versus lower, what are you talking about?
Upper as in that they're always gonna be on the tacky side, lower is they're gonna be on the brady side.
Why fourteen solid?
Say again?
Why fourteen solid?
Because they can never, their metabolism never slows down enough, they can actually regulate their heat side, okay? So these folks are always saying they're what, cold or hot?
Hot.
They're always hot, okay, open the window, open the door, whatever else along the way, okay?
Gray's pretty much a guaranteed onset of infib.
Yeah, well, the answer to that is yes, but not always immediately. So as Gray's disease gets worse, and Gray's disease is more prolonged, the idea that AFib will come along at some point in time, right? So the medications are gonna be on, it's gonna help regulate that, but never ever will take it away, just facing the disease process, okay?
So they have a fever?
They can have a fever. A fever not in the sense of like 101 or 102, but a fever in the sense of they're running a temperature high.
Sure.
Yeah?
It's not treatable?
It is treatable with medication, yes. To help regulate it.
Regulate, but
not, but again, remember, it's an autoimmune type thing, so you're not, it's not like you're going to dump this thing, right?
Why do their eyes pop out like that?
So, great question. I don't know that I know the science behind it, the path behind it as to what causes that. I just know that I've seen it before, and some of you probably have as well. The Marty Feldman look, if you remember him as an actor.
I've seen him borrow that.
That as well. Yeah. So what do we do about it? Supportive. All four things that we're talking about here, folks, are supportive. Except if they're a patient that's on AFib, might that lead to other things along the way, such as a heart issue along the way, right? So the idea in terms of do not get tough that just because you run on somebody with Graves' disease that they can't have other things going along with it as well. And oh, by the way, from what Deb just got finished talking about, they tend to be poor regulators as far as glucose. So getting glucose would be a smart move. So to the end point of this, okay, so Graves is the primary thing under thyrotoxicosis, but at the end point of this, there is something that's even worse, and that's this thyroid storm. I'll let you write, and then we'll talk.
Is that a different disorder?
That is Graves' disease on steroids. Okay.
So like a progressive?
Yep.
They
can have spikes in terms of this, okay? The idea that worst case scenario is this right here. This is when you get called. The idea that you're going to run on somebody typically with Graves' disease, not so much, all by itself. This, you'll get called.
Are they diabetic? Are we going to see diabetic
medication? All by itself, it's not a greater risk for diabetes per se. It just happens to run along with it in terms of their levels.
Can they treat them
with
the same meds?
I don't know that I know that answer.
And this is the only for Graves. This will only happen.
This particular one, yes, is Graves.
All these treatments only happen.
Yes.
Yeah,
right. So you're gonna hear about this history. Results from thyroid hormone moves from a bound state to a free state within the blood. And you see all the signs and symptoms that go along with this. So think about what we just got finished talking about with Graves' disease, but this spikes it in terms of whatever's happening.
What is the hormone bound to?
Say again?
What is the hormone bind to?
I don't know that. So again, what are we going to do with this?
Fluids?
We gotta fix these guys?
Mm-hmm.
right? So the idea in terms of supportive care is kind of like we're talking about. The idea, though, that if they're vomiting and diarrhea, giving some fluids along the way to support any dehydration certainly would be a smart move.
Do we know why it changes from the downstate to the end?
So there is, sometimes it is based on stress, sometimes it is based on a disease process. So some other disease process, i.e. the flu, can be something as simple as that will kick this. Okay. So it doesn't take a whole lot to get them there. All right, so this is the opposite side of the thyroid side, okay? This is the flu side of this, okay? I'll let you guys talk. Remember, they're already running fast to begin with, hacking to begin with. Giving good tiazem is still a good move for them.
Okay.
But it's not going to cure the AFib.
It's not
going to
interact with
their meds
or something.
Yeah. All right. So what is that saying to you? Just the opposite, right? So everything's kind of slowed down because of underproduction of T3, T4 that's producing this. So before we get there, next slide, how are these patients going to present? Say that again, Cameron.
Fatigue.
Groggy. What else? Lethargic. What else? Probably brainy, yeah. What else? Hot or cold?
Cold.
Can't get warm enough. Have you ever run on those patients? I cannot get warm enough along the way. Well, yeah, outside of that population, sure. There you go.
So they have dry, ashy skin, or
yeah, it's called doughy skin.
Doughy
skin. Don't ask why, I don't know, that's what it's called. But it looks like this dry eczema type of skin.
They're usually overweight on this one?
Yeah, because metabolism being slowed down. Yep.
Entire will be low.
Entire with poor perfusion, yes, will be low.
So this is autoimmune.
Virus probably that they kick them into, that's what we're saying, okay? Doesn't take a whole lot. So low amplitude bradycardia, what the word is that?
Borderline? QRS is low, yeah.
Waveform is about like this, right? So very, very short, small amplitude is what we're talking about. Because of why? Spot on. So do you think that Frank Starling is going to be an issue here in terms of this? Does that make sense?
I knew you had to say it. I got it before you did.
But the idea in terms of Frank Starling plays a part, meaning cardiac output is going to be a key for you all. So again, do you think that atropine is going to be a wonderful cure for increasing this bradycardia? Probably not. And pacing, maybe not.
We're not
going to cure this. We're going to try to get into a stable condition. Best case scenario. Make sense? Fluids will help only in the sense of anything that's going on from the rest of the disease process. But all by itself, not a whole lot.
Would Epi help in the
Epi will help in the short term, But there has been some talk and some discussion going on that heavy drip probably would help.
So atropine and casein don't have, you know, the same effect that they would have on a normal person. Do they have any effect, or is it totally reflective?
Yeah, you would expect to see some sort of a jump, but again, because of the disease process, what you're doing is probably going to be the short term.
I was just wondering, like, I mean, if you're coming from somewhere as far away as Chile, and you've got a severely bradycardic patient that is suffering from this, I mean, you can still use atropine.
Absolutely.
It's just not going to have
absolutely.
A strong effect.
So get this as well. Do you think these patients are going to be alert and talking to you in terms of running on them to begin with? So you may not know anything about this, right? You may not know anything about their medical history along the way. The idea that you start to use atropine and casein and the lights off and you're distracting your head going, why isn't this working well? Might be this is a consideration. Make sense?
So I'm saying that it can be inherited or acquired. How would you acquire this?
I don't know. Yep.
There's actually diets you can do to increase your thyroid, which you can burn it out and then go the other direction.
Right. Right. And so you, again, the balance is you can go too far one way or the other. I don't know.
They were doing studies on geographic locations being higher.
Great question.
Because Lee was telling me one time within Missouri, right?
Yeah.
Nobody was on.
Supportive care. Are we going to warm these folks?
No, because the body temperature normally runs well with the hypothyroidism.
Warming these folks is actually going to make this puppy worse. Okay. Can you do something in terms of, say, warm IV fluid? Yes. Are you going to actively warm them in terms of impacting the lights up?
Well, then,
blanket, yes.
Again, how do you know?
Yeah, I was going to say, it says
you may
triggered by hypothermia.
Yeah.
And so we're going to treat them by the...
You would think that makes sense. That's a logical thing that makes sense that we're going to warm them. This actually will make it worse in terms of warming the population. Tricky.
Which is fine because they're complaining that they can't stay warm enough.
Yeah.
But if they're in a coma, though...
Again, you may not know based on not knowing the history. You may not know. But my thing to you is if you know... that they've got myasthenia going on, the idea in terms of rapidly warming these folks.
What signs would you see that's making them go worse? Would it make them even more bradycardic?
Yes,
or,
cardiac arrest.
If you were trying to heat them up.
Cardiac arrest. Going from bradycardia into the behavior. Yeah. Yes. All right, are we okay? All right, so the flip side of this, their adrenal side. The hyper side, Cushing's, I'll let you write and then we'll talk. This is under medulla. Stand corrected, guys. This is cortisol. Now I'm going to do a little bit of cortisol. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So with that in mind, why does it matter? Why would this be a bad deal?
Tack out.
Okay, so tacky.
All adrenaline.
Good. Yep. What else about it? If it's in the cortisol, what is the cortisol responsible for again? So adrenaline was due to adrenaline, we have about epinephrine norepinephrine. What about cortisol? That's our immune response. Okay. So it's a steroid. It's a natural steroid released within the body. That's part of the immune response. So anytime there's an infection that kicks in or anything, anything along those lines, cortisol will be released and turned to the immune side to that to try to take care of business. So if the idea of this is tacking along and releasing too much cortisol, do you suppose the immune system is going to be a problem along the way in terms of healing? Yep. Sure.
So I don't know if these are related, but I understand that there's like a certain kind of like persistent visceral fat that is cortisol caused, and it's usually with people that are under like prolonged periods of high stress. So it says here that excess cortisol is often due to abnormalities in the adrenal cortex. So is that fat caused by this?
I don't know about the fat, but I know this is the disease process that creates that. So to answer your question,
this is what a lot of us suffer from. Police officers, first responders, all have all of this.
From getting up during the middle of the night and everything like that. Yeah. There's a certain amount of talk that goes on to this. Mm-hmm. And of the four, as firefighters, of the four, this is probably the one that we're most prompt, most apt to be sitting with.
Mainly police officers.
Yep.
Because they don't have any release after
this
stuff.
So hypokalemia may be an issue with this disease process. Hypokalemia, as in too low of K, potassium.
Is that because we burn it?
Yes. Metabolism side again that creates that, absolutely.
So if it's too bad, we can see, well, obviously, I'm answering my own question.
Sure.
I thought this condition was associated with weight gain. Is that incorrect? Fat specifically.
I don't know that I know that. I think it'd be weight loss, but I don't know that I know that. All right, so there's your signs and symptoms, and there you go, in terms of what contribute what they look like with the gut. So weight gain, moon face appearance, fat accumulation on the back, okay? This hump back that you sometimes will hear is classic in terms of cushions. Skin becomes thin and delayed healing of wounds, mood swings, impaired memory or concentration. That's nice. What does it matter?
Well, if they're unconscious and not in the doctor, so you can kind of assume.
This is a good idea what's going on.
Okay. What else? Skin becomes thin and delayed healing of wounds. What's that set up for?
More prone to sepsis.
Say again, John.
This guy has more prone to sepsis.
That's it right there. This is a setup for sepsis right here. The population is a setup for sepsis. Again, you just said we're over these folks. This is supportive care. This you should know the possibilities though of them having a stroke or an MI. And so a 12-lead, with any of the four that we're talking about, folks, 12-lead is a must.
Use caution with the IV setup?
Because of skin.
Okay.
Yeah, remember where it's thin and everything else like that? So skin tears would be a classic thing with this. Addison's is the fourth one.
Is that all three classes of steroids?
Yes.
How does the adrenal cortex get destructed,
destroyed? It's a self-immune type thing, just like everything else we're talking about. All four of these are really a form of a self-immune type thing that will create this. So anything in terms like a virus that will kick this, reason as to why 12 leads, why cardiac monitoring of these folks would be a good thing. Increased sodium excretion should mean what to you?
Dehydration,
right? So running fluids carefully, not just running, opening a line and saying, I'm going to give you 1,000 cc's is going to work for these folks. Because the idea that if any of the four of these, they're going to have a comorbidity. It's not like you're just going to have Addison's disease all by itself. They're going to have Addison's and some other stuff that kind of goes along with them. So be careful in terms of just assuming. There's your signs and symptoms.
What's hyperpigmentation?
Hyperpigmentation is like, have you ever seen skin, like a birthmark on the skin? So this is like a large birthmark on the skin, if you will, that comes along as a disease process.
Different than flora?
Kind of the same thing. It's just a bigger type thing. All by itself, it doesn't mean anything. It just happens to be something else that goes along with it.
I'm confusing two things. So you're telling me this is just a regular skin tone with a big birthmark on it versus the people that kind of have the whited out sections
So this is like a large birthmark. Okay. In my mind, that's the way I describe it.
What am I thinking of? Were there different?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
It was on the test yesterday. Was polycythemia, okay? The red skin?
No.
I got a teacher in junior high who had less pigmentation.
Shedding.
Vitiligo. All right, so what do you want to do with these guys? What do you want to do with this population? Hyper-K. And that should read hyper-K. Okay. What do you want to do with these folks? Fluid. Airway. Do you think it'd be a good idea in terms of 12 lead?
Yep.
Do you expect that you might see something symptomatic in terms of 12 lead? In its finest form, it's going to be.
I was going to
Why would I laugh about it? Because unless I saw, all by itself, unless I saw somebody with hyper-K on 12-lead, then we might talk about it. But bicarb all by itself, just because they happen to have Addison's disease, that's why I would laugh about it.
So do they treat these people with steroids?
Yes.
Because I have a dog.
It's an ongoing type thing. And remember, steroids don't come without some issues all by themselves, right? So the idea that you're creating one more problem just by trying to solve this problem. All right. We good with those four? Go back and take a look at your notes. Put them into something that works for you. Again, for me, that's kind of the way that I keep them somewhat straight.
Joe? Mentioned reduction of all three classes of hormones. What other three classes of hormones are we talking about for Addison?
It's on page 238. Glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids, and androgens.
So what they're talking about, Charlie, is within the adrenal cortex side, there's three hormones that sit in there. That's all they are, is being released.
Okay.
Right.
What about Addisonian crisis?
Addisonian crisis is again, kind of like thyroid storm, Justin, and that Addisonian crisis is just the worst case scenario of all that. So signs and symptoms become that much worse based
okay.
on that. That's all it is. All right, can I go away from this? So what I want to do is I want to kind of walk back through what Deb's lecture was this morning. There's no way on God's green earth, there's no way I can cut in terms of what she told me, okay? And it cannot hold no water at all in terms of it, okay? But what I do want to do is I want to go back and I kind of want to highlight a couple things along the way that probably would work well for you. Fair enough?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Talked about before, but just a reminder that when we talk about hormones, we talk about two different functions that it has. It has an endocrine and exocrine gland. Exocrine is along the lines of digestive side, while endocrine is in terms of regulation of what goes on as far as the bloodstream. And so when we talk about diabetes, we're talking about endocrine. When we're talking about exocrine, we're talking about some sort of digestive side that's happening. You should know these terms. She talked about them this morning. You should know them. Glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. Somebody tell me about glycogenolysis. Put it into practical terms how it might work.
The glucagon is a protein, peptide protein.
Good.
And it activates glucose in the liver.
Good. Like that. What else about it?
Glycogen is a chain with multiple glucose.
Yep.
And that's how we store it. So it's a breakdown of the individual glucose
Perfect.
Molecules off of the complex.
Perfect. And Gary's pea brain goes something like this. You're getting ready to have lunch here in just a couple minutes. I shouldn't have said because you're going to start thinking about lunch, okay? You're going to have lunch here in a couple minutes. Following lunch, what's going to happen is glycogenolysis is that it's going to break down whatever you have for lunch into a glucose to supply you for the afternoon. That's the way I think about it.
So it's just metabolism.
Yep.
So this is all sugars, not just water.
Yes, yes. So to that, the reason that you can go 6, 7, 8, 10 hours without eating again is that this will run in cycles as far as releasing glycogen over a period of time. Okay? If you didn't have this, the idea that you'd have to sit down for a meal every 2 hours, and I'm talking about a normal person, okay? I'm not talking about diabetic per se, but a normal person, you have to sit down every 2 hours and you didn't have this in place. So because of this, you have a series in terms of always breaking it down until it no longer can. When it no longer can, you start getting diabetics. That's when we're starting to talk about DKA and the lights up, okay?
So genesis is when it goes to the reserves, more so than just the genolysis one?
Yes.
The immediate food?
Yes.
Yep. So genesis is not, that's our own bodies, that's not...
Correct. Okay. That's our own bodies doing that thing.
It's not the macro nutrients.
Nope. All right, I don't think there's anything else here until we get to... Okay, I just want to walk through a couple of slides what Debbie was showing you. So only to pause here just long enough to remind you what you already know, and that is, it's kind of like you start talking about diabetics. And is it ever just diabetes all by itself? Is it ever just diabetes all by itself, right? It's always something else that's associated with it. It's always the death nail, if you will, in terms of coughing, because it creates so many other things along the way. And so having a healthy degree of respect, not only for the disease process, but what else it can create along the way. So just show, such as atherosclerosis, such as narrowing of the arteries, such as stroke, and it goes on and on and on and on in terms of possibilities. Talked about this already. Osmotic diuresis, greatly increased urination secondary to body not being able to reabsorb glucose, also prevents water reabsorption. That's nice. What does it mean?
Dehydration.
Yep. At what level? Glucose above what level does it start happening?
180,
right? So the idea that you run your diabetic and they happen to have a glucose of 250, you can believe what? There's probably some dehydration that's taken place unless they've done due diligence as far as trying to hydrate. Oh, I do want to go back for just a second, sorry. I'm gonna kind of hammer one other thing before we get into this. So we talked about this a long, long time ago. Let me go back and touch on this in terms of reminder. Okay, within the pancreas, there are three different cells: alpha cell, beta cell, and delta cell. Alpha cell secretes glucagon. Beta cell secretes insulin. Delta cell probably helps regulate the other two. It's still to this day, 2017, it's still not well studied as to what delta secretes. There is something that's called somatostatin that is the hormone within the delta side that regulates this, but again, it's not well understood. So alpha cells, beta cells, reminder that you should need to know that. Should know that already. So let's go back forward again. So insulin is released within the islets of Langerhans within the pancreas, okay? So islets of Langerhans is kind of like a subcategory within the pancreas, okay? Insulin is the principal control signal for conversion of glucose to glycogen. So the idea that glucose all by itself is this big old blob, cannot do its thing as far as the bloodstream goes, insulin is a helper. Got finished talking about this, but the idea in terms of peeing out with glucose is above 180 will be a big deal in terms of you running on your patients and the signs and symptoms you would expect to see with that. The idea that I've been up all night peeing, my first thing is what's going on with your glucose. So So in the end, diabetes mellitus, it doesn't matter type 1 or type 2, is either no insulin that's produced or some insulin in the decreased amount. In your own words, what happens with type 1 and type 2? What's the difference? So insulin-dependent juvenile diabetes, type 1, however you want to term that, is going to be no secretion of insulin. So as Debbie was talking about this morning, the idea that they have to be on insulin shots because of lack of insulin being produced. Whereas type 2, check this out, type 2, there can either be some insulin produced or very little insulin produced. So the idea that the more that a pancreas gets hammered along the way in terms of the disease process, the less it's going to have in terms of insulin production. And so you can have type 2 diabetics, like she was talking about this morning. You can have type 2 diabetics that are on insulin because of finding out how much insulin produces or doesn't produce along the way.
Question.
Yeah.
Say if we get a test question, you know the next question. Are we going 80 to 140?
You're talking about a glucose level?
Yeah.
Most standardized things will say 70 is the number. You will sometimes see 60, but generally 70 is the accepted number. High number normal is 110 to 120. Characterized by low production of insulin, you should know that already. The idea in terms of what happens, though, that when they go into a crisis is the bigger deal. Results of pronounced hyperglycemia, symptoms of untreated type 1 will include, you should know these terms, polydipsia, polyuria, polyphagia, weight loss, and weakness. I'm going to show you a slide, and she may have showed you a slide this morning of the cycle of these folks eating and why they do. Untreated, non-compliant patients may progress to ketosis and diabetic ketoacidosis. So what happens here, folks? And Karen, you asked her a term to what's going on with the ketones. Why does this matter, guys?
Metabolic acidosis.
Right. So the ketones result in metabolic acidosis. As she told you this morning, the body will find a way in terms of getting fat stored. Will work at it very, very, very well. Not efficiently, but very, very well in terms of getting what it needs. Okay? So the idea that with a type 1, ketoacidosis is your enemy. That's why they're so sick. Okay. Yeah.
But in the polycystic, so excessive
urination. We'll come back to it. We'll dig into it. All right, type 2, we already talked about the fact that they've got some insulin, typically, some insulin production going along the way. It doesn't mean that you can't have somebody with extreme hyperglycemia. You can. The difference is that this population doesn't necessarily kick ketones as being the fat stores because they have some insulin that play a part in this. Does that make sense? So the idea when we talk here in just a couple of minutes about the high side of this, the difference is that ketones is not the huge enemy here. She talked about this, I'm not gonna talk about that. Hypoglycemia, again, you know the signs and symptoms. Okay, so diabetic ketoacidosis. Let's camp here and let's talk a little bit more about this. Did you see this with type 1 or type 2?
Type 1,
right? Sensation of insulin injections and increase in glucose. With type 1s, that glucose can be much, much lower than type 2. So they can trigger this so-called hyperglycemia in this population can be triggered at 300, 400. And again, you may not know it by your glucometer because it just reads high. So you may not know exactly where the levels are at. Nevertheless, it kicks in a little bit lower than type 2s. Causes release of catecholamines. Why is that important to you? Catecholamines. Yep, that's part of it, but what else? Catecholamines. Tacking along. So everything could be tacking along. Respiratory side, cardiac side, Kuznal respirations result because of catecholamines. I'll let you write and then we'll talk.
Yeah,
type 1 because of the insulin. I'm about the insulin. It releases the ketones that benefit. Right. All right, so let's do some terminology. What's polyuria? Being like crazy, right? What is polydipsia? Thirsty. They're always thirsty. The fact that they're always drinking. I'll show you why that happens. What is polyphagia?
Excessive hunger.
Do what?
Hunger.
I'm sorry, again.
Excessive appetite.
Yeah, so they're always eating, okay? And I'll show you again how that works. They're warm and dry. Skin membranes are very dehydrated along the way. Nausea and vomiting, abdominal pain, tachycardia, Kussmaul respirations, fruity odor, fever, alternative consciousness. How long does it take to kick the cycle? We're talking about minutes, we're talking about hours, we're talking about days. This is days. Before you get involved in this, before you get tagged into this call, guess what, folks? On average, it will be two days worth of symptoms before you ever get there. Okay, so you get there at the very end in terms of them being sick, 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 and that's this sick right here. Let me turn on the lights and see if you can't see that. All right, so starting at the very, very top there, lack of insulin is a problem here. Lack of insulin results in hyperglycemia, yes? So follow on to the cycle then. That results in them being thirsty. So they're drinking. And oh, by the way, are they peeing?
Yep.
Glucoses are above 180, so they're peeing out no matter how much they take in. So it's the result in profound dehydration. Thank you. Dehydration will lead to electrolyte imbalance, K being one of them, but not the only one. Sodium would be the other one, right? So two major electrolytes, sodium and potassium. Do you think that's going to have an issue in terms of the cardiac side?
Yeah.
Makes sense? So electrolyte imbalance leads to polydipsia. Polydipsia leads to lack of energy. Lack of energy leads to breakdown of fats and proteins. So the idea that they're eating, do you suppose that they're eating something that's healthy for them? Or they're eating fats, right? Because they're profoundly hungry. Polyphagia is thirst.
Hungry?
Yep.
Yeah,
you're right. Sorry. Polydipsia, Timmy, is thirsty. Polyphagia is if they're hungry. Lack of energy leads to breakdown of fats and proteins. Why does this matter right here? So remember, the body's got to go somewhere in terms of getting its glucose, right? Is it efficient in terms of going to the fat side, fat storage? No way. That fat side is going to lead to this right here. And this is the intersection, if you will, in terms of what happens with DKA. Ketones are released. Ketones release causes acidosis. Metabolic acidosis. Not respiratory, metabolic acidosis. Okay? Kussmaul respirations come in right about here. Which increases in blood lipids being released. Polyphagia, eating, goes right back into insulin. So the idea in terms of this going over and over and over 2 to 3 days before you get called into this, this is the reason why they're unconscious. This is the reason why they're so stinking sick once you get on scene with this cycle right here. Yeah.
So I'm kind of confused on this cycle with regards to the polyphagia being after they're in a coma.
They may not be in a coma. Charlie, you can have folks that live in this cycle for 2 to 3 days before they ever end up into a coma.
Okay, so when their increasing ketones is happening, they get acidotic, and then that's when the polyphagia comes into play, where they have to eat, and then that utilizes any insulin that they may or may not.
Yep. Which eventually then will lead into a coma. But again, they can live this way depending on your patient population. They can live this way for a day or two. All right. We okay with DKA? You kind of have an understanding about DKA? Go back and look at your notes. Go back and look at your book. Go back and look at what we're talking about today. You're going to need to know that. Okay? Take that. Nope. I want you to know those phases, but not necessarily in that order. I want you to know what it's all about. All right, type 2. we talked about the fact that type 2 is more towards some insulin being produced. Type 2 is about our population. Type 2 is about, especially these days, the juveniles with obesity and the likes of. Type 2 is the big girl, big boy on campus, if you will. Signs and symptoms include polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia, warm and dry skin, and mucous membranes, and orthostatic hypotension. What's missing there? Close. Ketones. So the ketones are not necessarily the thing here because there's some insulin that's taking care of business. Okay, that's the difference here.
So these guys don't go into metabolic acidosis.
They will go into an acidosis, but not necessarily the severity of the metabolic acidosis because ketones are not being released.
In the field, there's really no way for us to tell.
That's an excellent point. You may or may not know, okay? But the way, and again, my pea brain, the way I'm thinking about this, is if I have a type 1 with a high level, I'm thinking more about DKA.
Sure.
But the type 2, I'm thinking about more about...
Hydrosmolar, yeah.
Yeah. Did I have a slide for that?
Yeah.
Okay. With a type 2, I'm thinking more about this. So hyperosmolar, non-ketotic, diabetic, coma. Hyperglycemic, hyperosmolar, non-ketotic, acidosis. So Debbie was talking about this morning, how high have you seen levels? The idea with a type 2, you can see levels that are much, much greater than a DKA along the way. Very, very common.
Gary, why would a CBA precipitate this?
A CBA would, I don't know that I could
fix it. The way she explained it was the amount of glucose occluding
coronary arteries,
right? Even the brain.
Yeah.
That's the way she explained it.
Mm-hmm.
But why would CBA?
I would just think more fully managed type 2 diabetes.
I don't really answer that, Jim.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, not CBA.
Just into the brain?
That'd be my guess, but I don't know. All right, so what does this population mean? It's like Kieran said, what do both these populations need in the end?
Insulin.
So they need insulin ultimately in terms of fixing them, okay? So the idea that most pre-hospital places are not carrying insulin is why? They don't trust us or what? Part of it is some of it has to be refrigerated depending on which kind you're carrying.
The rate of how much you need to do.
That's it right there. The idea in terms of you cannot just slam insulin and it'll make us all better. Okay. While they're not using a sliding scale that she was talking about this morning, while they're not using a sliding scale per se, they do close monitoring in terms of calculating for DKA as to how much they're going to drop that glucose over a period of time. It's kind of like we talked about hypertensive emergencies. It isn't like you just take and dump this in terms of glucose, okay, and like it's better. It doesn't work that way. So it's over a period of time they'll end up doing it. So the idea that we're going to make a huge difference in the 10, 15, 20 minute transport that we have, probably not so much.
And we're treating obesity.
Check. But from a treatment standpoint,
from
it's the same. Yeah. So I do want to comment on something along those lines, okay? So you're absolutely right in terms of running fluids. You want to run fluids on both these populations without a doubt, okay? But check this out. Again, if we said that diabetes is a disease all by itself, they don't have hypertension, they don't have cardiac issues, they don't have respiratory issues along the way. So the idea there's always going to be a comorbidities, and the idea that just coming in and opening up two bags and running them wide open without going back and regulating it to what's going on with the rest of your patient is bad medicine. So you're absolutely right. We do want to run fluids, we want to run a lot of fluids. So fluids is part of the thing in terms of dehydration, but you have to be monitoring along the way in terms of the rest of the disease process. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So it's never an innocent thing of just opening up without following up on that. You should know this already, but in your book, there is a large diagram, the difference between DKA and hypoglycemia in terms of signs and symptoms. You need to know that.
Type
Are we able to assume that the AKK is going to be very similar to the diabetic?
For the, Charlie, for the most part, absolutely. It's going to be very, very close. The idea is that are you going to have a fruity odor on somebody that's HHNK? No, because ketones are not being kicked out. So there are some differences and similarities. But yeah, you're right. All right. So I'm not going to camp here. Go back and take a look at any diagrams. You know, we'll ask you about
it. HHS coma and HHNK coma, are they assuming the same thing?
Yes. Yes, same thing.
Is that?
It's just terminology.
Is there a particular terminology you'd prefer that we?
That. That's what I will ask you about.
No.
And all it is, folks, is just terminology.
Can you turn your attention to system?
Yep. And that's my spiel. Any questions from this morning from either Deb's or mine or anything else we can help you with?
We kind of talked to her about it. What are your thoughts about the glucagon versus D50?
So,